Here is an early picture showing some of the dates and the package counts. Shows in 74, 10,000 pieces, but I think in 78 it was only up to 50. So it wasn't, the growth was pretty slow at that point, but from 78 on, after the advertising began, things really started to happen and grow fast. So we hit 100,000 in November of 80 and 200,000 2 years later. So it was, the growth was really, really happening. Our radio department and the dad's group also was growing. After Julie came on board, our first radio technician engineer was Richard Dunn. And since I was traveling in one area, he was traveling somewhere else, and we were installing radio systems, you know, all over the place. We had the first radio transmitter at the top of the World Trade Center, position one, row one. And that was breaking new ground. We were the first one up in Sears Tower, I think I mentioned that as well. Also, out in San Francisco, we were the first commercial two-way operator up in the Sutro Tower, if you ever noticed that strange tower sitting on top of Sutro Hill, down, overlooking San Francisco city area. We were up there at that time. So we were going for coverage, for distance. Later on in New York, we found that one site wasn't enough. We had to get multiple sites. And so I had spent many, many hours with the FCC looking for some waivers, some way to work around getting licensing, getting a special consideration. And they were very excited about what our company was doing, because nobody in the industry anywhere was doing using the spectrum as we were being licensed at spectrum in a way that was as effective and efficient as we were. So they were. I made trips often to Washington to keep them updated to make sure that we were getting what we needed. We had a very prized set of 800 licenses all over the country, and. In New York, for instance, as it grew, we wound up with 10 channels and 30 licenses, 30 systems, which was a very high reuse, but nobody else was achieving anything like that at that time. We grew our data group to develop the special applications needed for the systems out there in Chicago, New York, and St. Louis. We were really building a distributed processing system before distributed processing was really well adapted as an architecture, all based on IBM's 3270 ESNA network, which is extremely robust, and it had its own set of issues that had to be overcome because of the very high volumes of transactions that were being processed through that machine. Those machines every day. I think from its humble beginnings, I think these are the kinds of things that made, you know, FedEx really stand out in the industry. We introduced satellite networking. That was a very big deal. We hired a couple of engineers from Scientific Atlanta, and we installed a backbone network using a very new technology, TDMA technology. That American Satellite was offering. So we had a system, we had a base site in Memphis at the on the Presley Farm area in the back near the call center, and a location in New Jersey, Edison, New Jersey.
Small deal, this is a very big deal. This is across the street from Edison from the call center. There was a hole built in the ground that had to be pumps for floods and the high wall around it to protect it from interference, and then you see the earth station. These earth stations were fairly large in diameter, about 13 meters across. They were C-band systems. There was one also out in the Sacramento area, and it was microwave to the call center. So it proved that while this was providing a good network for data, it wasn't so good for voice because of the delay, but by using the satellite in our advertising, it was sort of an icon showing that FedEx was definitely moving into the future, and it probably made us more in advertising money than it did saving us money from land-based terrestrial networks. Fiber was coming on strong at this point, and I think the Zapmail was also happening, and satellite was again being looked at, but the fiber technology was now
becoming cheaper and cheaper and more available, and the company basically let the satellite approach go and adapted more of its land-based networks for all of the facilities that the company needed. You know, I think the early days of FedEx with call centers, with Cosmos 2B, the DAD system, I mean, those were all innovative. I mean, the vision of Fred Smith, when I first joined the company and I went to talk to him and asked him, what do you envision for the company? He told me that he envisioned a robot out and about picking up and delivering packages. That's what I remember. I'm sure it was a longer story than that, but that's the part that stuck with me because it was so visual. The idea of the precision, accuracy, and reliability of that robotics and automation could bring, that's where his head was at. And you can see it through the whole company. He always was pushing folks for better automated ways of doing things to eliminate the possibility of error.